Hi everyone. So it's my pleasure to present you this work. This is work that was done with my colleagues Luca Bruno, Mariano Graziano, Davide Balzarotti. Luca and Mariano did present this work at DEF CON a few weeks ago, but they were unfortunately not able to come today for presenting it, so that's my turn. Good, so you all know the internet is made of plenty of networks, right? All those networks, they talk to each other, or in order to have everyone being able to be reaching everyone on the internet, you have this BGP protocol on those routers that actually do the glue on interconnection between several networks. So some people are even able to make some very cool pictures from that. So there you see each dot is a BGP network, right? And the lines are the connections between the routers, right? So that's a lot of networks. So therefore, this BGP network, it's a worldwide network, and each BGP router has its own AS routing table. So this is an autonomous system, right? One of those networks is an autonomous system, AS. And they have a routing table that basically tells some routes, and then you have some default routes, and so on. So they don't have a global view, right? They have a local view of the internet. So because of that, what you see really depends on where you are, right? So there is a small picture here from an example of an event that occurred where you have one network that actually broadcasts its own routes, right? And the other network, the other BGP routers receive those routes and are expected to take care of those routes. But then another network is broadcasting another announcement, we call it. And then some networks in the middle get confused, get the wrong announcement, but some other networks here don't get the wrong one, right? They get the original one because the fake route doesn't propagate to them. So this is just to illustrate that the internet is not uniform, and sometimes you have some problems that are pretty hard to detect. What you see from one place is not the same thing as you see from another place, right? So in order to debug these kind of problems, you need some troubleshooting tools, right? On the NOC, the Network Operation Centers, they have a set of tools. So there are some well-known, like the RIP Labs, they have several sensors on the internet where they listen to all the BGP announcements. So they receive the BGP announcements, and they log them so that you can do some forensics, some analysis, and so on. There is the NL NOG, which is actually a group of network operators that actually share shells on machines, right? So this is well organized, and so if you want to debug a network, then you can go log in on some machine on some remote location, and then do some network troubleshooting. But this requires some. Not everyone can have this, right? And then you have those web access to routers. So they are just a web page, right? That gives you some limited access to the routers, and this is what you call is called looking glass, right? So what does a looking glass looks like, right? A looking glass is just some simple web interface, right? That provides you some small interface. So there, for example, you have the choice of doing query, a BGP, a ping, or a trace, right? So you can choose IPv6 or IPv4. You can choose the router you want to make the request from. And then you put a parameter for the IP address or the domain. Here is my own website. And then when you send, then you have the web page that shows you the ping from that router in Poland to my own server, so I can know the latency, or you can get the trace route, and so on. So all that is very good. It's very useful for debugging network problems. And actually, it's by one day trying to debug some network problem that we got a bit curious about this. So how does it work? Such networks, you basically have a web server that is inside an autonomous system. It has a public-facing web server. And then it's connecting to the internal network of the autonomous system. It's connecting to the administration network, right, of the autonomous system. It can talk to the routers, right? So usually those web interfaces, they are able to, they have a way to talk to the router, right? And then someone can actually from the internet, from anywhere on the internet, go to the website and then send those commands. So based on this, we thought it was nice to make a study. So we make a study because there are a lot of those tools that are open source. So we looked at those, I think it's 4 or 5. So we did a study of their source code review. And then we look at actual deployments. So we look at public, so there are some public lists, right? You can find website where there are lists of Looking Glasses, and then we made some search queries as well to find more. And then we try to evaluate the impact of this. So the common design for those tools is actually very bad, right? Most are like 90s style web scripts. They are usually in PHP or in Perl, and there are sometimes a single file that you can drop in a web root. And most of them, they have the ability to directly connect to the SSH or Telnet administration console of a router, right? And of course, those needs to have some configuration to access those routers, like credentials. So from them, you imagine that you can have a lot of potential problems, right? You can imagine, because they are all crappy web scripts, you can imagine all sorts of basic web problems like cross-scripting, injections, and so on. You can expect some misconfigured not hardened servers, some credentials that are not properly protected, and some network configuration that are not correct, right? And well, actually, so we searched for that, and we actually found all of that, right? All of those problems were actually present. So I'll now give some examples. So for example, we found some very basic cross-SIP scripting. So you see that you can actually, instead of putting the IP address, you can put the IP address on some script and then it gets executed. So this could be if the administrator is actually having this, is using this and it has some other access to other web applications in the same domain, this could be used to steal cookies. Then you have some services that have a default pass for the configuration files. So some tools, they have like this lg.conf configuration file. So those configurations, of course, they are in plain text. They include the IP addresses, the username, and the passwords. And they are at some basic URLs, right? So then we can do some Google Docs, right? So Google search query to find, like, if you search for login telnet and then in URL lg.conf, then if you do this, you find plenty of them, right? And of course, you can access them. They include configuration is actually including the login and the passwords. Sometimes you can even browse the index and get access to them. Right? of course, if you read the README of the tool, they warn you that it's a bad idea not to protect your configuration files. Right? What is shocking is that it's clearly written, right? But still, we found like 28 cases where you could actually directly get the configuration file with the Cisco passwords in it. So some are more secure because they use SSH and not Telnet, but then they sometimes put the private key, private SSH key in the web root, right? And without any protection against, it's world readable, right? So this is pretty bad again. In another case, so we made a sort of an audit of several of those tools. On some Looking Glass actually bring their own third-party tools. And there was this FastPing setuid tool, a binary. And FastPing is, as you expect, some better ping, right? Because the original ping is not good enough, probably. And that one was actually getting the ICMP echo reply, and it was getting a parameter to make a lookup in a table, right, without checking the values of the parameter. So there was no, I mean, it was using the contents of the ICMP reply without validation. So we actually filled, we filled many CVEs, but one in particular for that one. And what is shocking is that the vendor for the Looking Glass software actually said, well, that's third party. Okay, so then the third party said, well, that tool shouldn't ever, this piece of code shouldn't ever be used for anything serious, it's just a demo. So that was closed as a won't fix. We didn't have actually a real exploit for this one, but we're afraid it's exploitable. Then, so it's really the horror museum of horrors. So there was another Looking Glass where you could actually do some simple command injection, it's just like putting a new line after the parameter. So after in this form, you put the IP address, and then you put an, you encode a new line, and then you can execute commands on the router. So in summary, we had six CVEs that we reported on many open source tools. So as we have seen, there are some remote code command injection, some cross scripting, some remote memory corruptions, unsafe default configuration, and so on. So most of those are so simple that they would be in a CTF, they would be the Web 100, right? They would be the first challenge in a CTF. But what's sad is that those are actually affecting a lot of autonomous systems. So like about more than 40-45 autonomous systems that we found were vulnerable to those. So basically we made a study where we actually look at all the autonomous systems we could that were using those tools, and then we try to check the configuration and so on. So there we have a small, so it's really spread, the spread of those autonomous systems in the world is really spread. So there were a bit more in Russia, sorry for that. But overall it was quite spread. So the main question from now is, okay, now that you can, we show that, okay, there are so many problems and most of them are likely to give you a shell on the router, right? Question from there is, okay, but then can you use this to actually break the internet, right? So the easiest way to tell this, right, the easiest way to verify that we can actually go and inject some fake routes, advertise some fake BGP prefix, would be to try it, of course. That would be the easy way. Of course, we didn't do that because it's not really a good idea. We tried to get as many contacts as we could with governments, certs, and so on. On some operators as well. It wasn't very, we never got a real confirmation that it was possible to exploit this. And it was, because there are many things that could happen, right? If you have maybe you can execute something on the router, but maybe the router is fully patched onto a recent version and the accounts that you use is very restricted. That could be possible, right? Maybe that account is not able to change the configuration, but only to do some very basic commands. That we didn't know. What we did is we looked at some BGP monitoring data sets. Right? We had some colleagues working on this, on trying to find some BGP hijacks. So we looked for those routers that we knew were vulnerable. Right? And we tried to find the history of the announcements those routers made. Right? So that, with the idea that if someone actually exploited those bugs before, we may see some weird stuff advertised by those routers. We actually did not find any clear evidence. There were a few things that were strange, right? We found a few incorrect announcements or some prefixes that were too large, but we didn't find any real evidence of misuse. Moreover, if you get a router to send a route, it doesn't mean you can actually break much because if this IS is actually connecting through a bigger one, the bigger one may filter out incorrect announcements. Right? So this is very much possible. So in conclusion, we look at this part of the historic web that is connected to very highly critical systems, right? And we found many issues on that. We coordinated the disclosure. Actually, we had an embargo. Even the DEF CON abstract was sort of obfuscated until a few weeks ago. Well, I did not even mention the countermeasures in this talk because the countermeasures are so simple and basic, right? So the countermeasures, I don't know exactly. I mean, they are very simple. Don't do stupid web scripts and don't connect them to your to your routers, right, to your BGP routers. That's a bad idea. Isolate your networks and so on. So some of those credentials, sometimes you should only be able to connect. If you get some credentials for a BGP router, you should not be able to connect to it because it should be on this administration network, right? But some of those routers were actually found the SSH or telnet port open on the internet, from the internet, right? So, countermeasures are just a good practice, right? Then the last question is, okay, how many similar critical systems are left with 90s style web security, web interfaces? Maybe there are some more, but surprise like that. We hope most of, I mean, most of the bugs are now corrected, and I think most of the AS got informed of the problems, and I hope most of this is fixed by now. Okay, thank you. So, thank you, and I'll take questions.
Any questions for Aurélien? I got one question. Did you get access with this SSH private key?
What? So
did you actually try to SSH connect to this router using this private key? What you doing? Yeah.
Just admit. No, we didn't.
Don't incriminate yourself.
No, we didn't.
Yeah, that was really cool talk. I wonder if you know you could actually study the snowball effect without actually being destructive. Instead of trying to inject those BGP routes all together, you could possibly try to inject them one after the other, and not necessarily, you know, disrupt the whole internet at once. So yeah. Maybe just like localizing the effect of each injection point would actually allow you to.
Yeah, maybe we could have find who are those routers and see if they are important or just like some own router in the corner
right.
of the internet.
Yeah, that would have been nice to have like a pretty picture of that too. You gotta come here.
You could use it like it was recently used with a Bitcoin pool, steal the Bitcoins and use that as a measurement.
Could we use this to steal Bitcoins? Yeah, hijacking routes could be. We didn't try.
It's all about metrics. Like this is the real science of security.
Okay, thank you.